Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, 7 Ways to Turn Student Engagement into Student Agency. We appreciate your taking the time to join us today and are looking forward to the next hour together. First, I'd like to thank Student Success Agency for sponsoring today's webinar. Student Success Agency helps students become the very best versions of themselves socially, emotionally, and academically by connecting them on demand with their very own agents for mentoring, tutoring, and post-secondary advising. We'll be sharing a little bit more about Student Success Agency later on in the webinar, so stay tuned for that. Before we begin the presentation, I'm going to just run through a few quick tips and how-tos to help the webinar go smoothly for you. First, we will be accepting questions throughout the webinar, and we'll hold a Q&A at the end. You can use the questions box on your control panel to send a question in, and I'll put it into the queue to be answered during the Q&A. If you have any technology problems during the webinar, you can use that same questions feature to get my attention, and I'll do my best to resolve the problem for you. One thing you can do right now to help things go smoothly is to close all of the other applications on your computer, and I know that is super hard to do, but close all of your internet browser tabs, close Word, PowerPoint, any Adobe applications you have open, and just have GoToWebinar open, and that just has all of your internet and computer bandwidth going to power GoToWebinar, and it can really smooth out audio and video lags. If you do have lags that last more than a second or two, you can close out of GoToWebinar and come right back in, and that often resets the connection for you. We are recording today's webinar, so if you're not able to stay for the whole thing or want to share the program with colleagues, we'll be sending you a recording of it by email tomorrow, as well as a copy of the slide deck. So keep an eye on your inbox for those materials. All right, I think we've taken care of all of our housekeeping business, so let's switch gears and welcome Dr. Monica Burns.
Hello, everyone. I'm very excited to be here with you today for today's session. I'm going to go ahead and make my screen a little bit bigger here so I can go into full screen mode and we can go ahead and get started.
Great. Well, we're happy to have you here, Monica. And just a brief background for those of you who don't know Monica. I know many of you do from ClassTechTips.com, but Monica is a curriculum and edtech consultant and founder of that popular blog, podcast, and website, ClassTechTips.com. As a classroom teacher, Monica realized the power of the technology tools in her classroom, and she started ClassTechTips.com to provide a resource for educators and administrators on implementing edtech. Today, she works with schools across the country to make technology integration exciting and accessible for teachers. She is a frequent presenter at national and international conferences and is also the author of several books, her newest being published by ASCD, EdTech Essentials. So welcome, Monica, and we'll go ahead and let you get started.
Well, thank you so much. I'm very excited to be here with you all today for our session. And so as we jump into our session for today, I want to start off by just giving a little bit of an overview of what we'll be discussing together today. And as you heard, you have a question area of that GoToWebinar control panel. So I hope that if you have any questions as we go through, that you use that space to make sure we're able to grab them and answer them during our time together today. So during our time together, we've got a few different things that we're going to focus on. We're going to start off looking at strategies for how to rethink student engagement through student agency, why having a plan for student engagement is essential. We'll look at some strategies for building social emotional learning and fostering student voice. And we'll think about how to plan with social emotional learning and student engagement in mind during our time together today. Now, as we get ready to talk about these big topics of student engagement and student agency and make those social emotional learning connections together, I thought it would be good to start off with just setting us up for success by talking about this term student engagement, unpacking it a little bit as we get ready to look at our 7 ways, our 7 tips together today. So what is student engagement? Sometimes when we think of student engagement, it's a I know it when I see it situation. But let's think a little bit about the types of things that we're looking for and that we think about when this big term student engagement comes into play. So students are in a high interest environment when they are truly engaged in their learning experience. They are curious, they are interested in the content, they're interested in the types of activities that they are participating in. It has grabbed their attention. So if it grabs their attention, they are hooked, they are in the moment, unpacking content, solving a problem, asking or help for the person next to them, or having a conversation with one of their peers. A student, an environment that is high in student engagement, that is very engaging for students, supports their interests. So it is purposefully connected to the types of things students are interested in learning about. Now, it doesn't mean that we are ignoring curriculum goals that we might have, but instead there's a connection to what kids care about, what's important to them, what they've demonstrated interest in, things that educators might figure out from conversations one-on-one with students, listening into whole class discussions, or even having an interest survey where we're gathering information on what students truly are interested and exciting about. But when it comes to student engagement, for me, coming back to that, you know it when you see it situation, there truly is students in the flow of learning. They're not looking at the clock. They are not excited when the bell rings. They are truly in the flow. They are in the zone, right? They are all about whatever is happening in that particular learning environment. So when we're looking at different spaces and wondering if student engagement is really present, those are few things that we can take into consideration. I wanted to share a quote with you from a great article for ASCD on four secret keys to student engagement. Engaged learners often pursue their own train of thought about the topic under study, regardless of the task at hand. Engaged learners tend to focus on the learning and share their thoughts unprompted without consideration for those around them. These learners take risks. They're not afraid to try something new. So this quote comes back to that idea of truly being in the flow. And you'll have access to the presentation deck, so you'll be able to explore or unpack this article a little bit more if you'd like to revisit it. Now, as we think about these pieces and we ask ourselves about student engagement and expand upon it to include student agency, one of the big ideas in our title, our topic for today, student agency truly includes student choice. It honors student voice, and it brings in relevant experiences and an authentic audience for students. So today, as we talk about student agency, you'll hear me come through all of these pieces, really looking at opportunities for students to make a choice, to say what it is that they want to explore further or learn more about. It honors student voice, where we are listening in and providing opportunities for students to share. There are relevant and authentic experiences for students, so really truly based in on something that makes a sense to students, that they can wrap their head around, that they've had experiences with outside of the classroom and a connection is being made. And oftentimes, if students are producing something, they are making an artifact of their learning, there is an authentic audience, someone who is going to be entertained or persuaded or informed by their work product, by their creation. So to continue with thinking deeply about this term student agency, I wanted to share another quick quote from you, another ASCD article from Will Richardson, where we look at this idea of student agency and the curriculum connection. Curriculum matters, but only to the extent that it is used to support a student's inquiry. In neglecting this aspect of independent learning, many schools are missing the opportunity to give students true agency over their learning. So side by side, right, adjacent to curriculum goals that schools might have for students, there's an opportunity when we take student agency into play to connect it to what kids are curious about, what they're interested in, what they're truly motivated to learn more about. Now, before we look at our seven tips today, seven ways to connect that student engagement piece to student agency, I want to make sure that we are always coming back to the social emotional learning connection. And you'll hear this come up a few different times as we unpack some different examples together. Now, social emotional learning is so much more than a buzzword. And if you've heard SEL thrown around a little bit this past school year, this summer, moving into the fall, it really is around a commitment to making sure students have everything they need for a successful school year that goes beyond what might be on a list of traditional standards or curriculum goals that you are reviewing for students in a content or academic area. So for a social emotional learning connection, we're really looking at five different areas, and these come from Castle's framework. Unpacking these five areas is some of the work that they do, and I'll point you to some research and more information if you are building a foundation for social emotional learning, skill building in your current learning environment. So here we are looking at a few different things: self-awareness, self-management, social awareness, relationship skills, and responsible decision making. Sometimes these are brought into conversations as a responsive measure when something has taken place and we want to have a conversation with students. Other times it's coming together in more of a proactive way, modeling behaviors as a school community to help students have an example that they can point to and they can build off of as you make a social emotional learning part of a school-wide goal. So these pieces, the self-awareness, self-management, social awareness, relationship skills, and responsible decision-making, go beyond the four walls of a classroom or a school building or at a district level into the pieces that we want to make sure students are able to transfer outside of a school into the spaces that they inhabit after their school career is over, moving on from a college and career readiness standpoint, and also in their day-to-day lives, both inside and outside of a school building. So as you hear me talk a little bit about an SEL connection with our strategies today, you can always check out the Castle landing page, castle.org. They have a great resource, a great page called What is the Castle Framework that I often point educators to in conversations like the one we're having today. So SEL is the process through which all young people and adults acquire and apply the knowledge, skills, and attitudes to develop healthy identities, manage emotions, and achieve personal and collective goals. Feel and show empathy for others, establish and maintain supportive relationships, and make responsible and caring decisions. So this idea of social emotional learning is not a one and done or a lesson that takes place at the start of the school year. It is something that is really threaded through all of the learning opportunities that students are provided with over the course of a school year. So taking these pieces into consideration today, we are going to look at seven ways to turn student engagement into student agency. So really focusing in on the priorities of making sure kids are interested and engaged, all right? They are really deep and in the flow of their learning, but at the same time, giving them that agency to go off, to explore things they're curious about, things they want to learn more about, and that they're motivated to dive into a little bit deeper. At the same time, as we look at these seven ways, there'll be many opportunities to thread in SEL or social emotional learning goals that you might have for the students that you work with or support over the course of the school year. So first on our list today is to provide time to explore interest, really showing students that this is something that you value by carving out time for them to explore their interests, things that they've expressed, that they've shared, that they're ready to dive into more deeply. Now, when it comes to providing time to explore interests, we know that there are only so many hours of the day. There's a lot of things on list of priorities, but if we really are committed to providing an environment where students are highly engaged and they're taking that next step to do something that they're motivated to explore explore something a little bit more deeply, then providing time to explore interests is one way to help make that connection. So this should go beyond an interest survey, even though an interest survey is often a great place to start. It's by taking the information that is gathered, whether that is a formal interest survey full of open-ended questions or a few multiple choice questions to get students comfortable sharing, or whether it is something less formal with conversations that might be taking place in small groups or with individual students. You can go beyond just collecting that information to really carve out time for students to explore interests. I often put this in the we don't know what we don't know category, right? Sometimes we don't know what questions to ask if we don't have enough context. Sometimes we don't know that we want to go down a certain pathway to explore or look up some more information on a topic until we truly get started. So this might take place as part of a coordinated effort to give students an opportunity to explore their interests more deeply. So this is where that shift from the engagement to the agency piece of students going out, exploring something, taking some sort of action. So this might be part of a genius hour or a 20% time initiative that takes place for every student or a group of students that you work with. So carving out time for students to dive into something that is not necessarily on a to-do list from a curriculum standpoint, but is directly connected to the interest that they've expressed or that they are looking to dive into a little bit more deeply. It truly requires us to put time on the calendar to carve out time for students to take part in the types of activities that might connect to their interests. Going out and researching something, interviewing something, finding out more information. If we truly value and prioritize this, we need to put that time on the calendar to make it happen. By doing this, carving out time, providing time for all these pieces, we are showing the value of this, that we know that it is important, but we can be very transparent by showing the value of this time, by honoring it in schedules, making sure it's not the first thing that's cut when there's a schedule disruption that takes place over the course of the day. And going back to examples of how this time is being used, not only for those that you might be convincing that this is a good use of everyone's time, but for the students that are participating to celebrate the small, big accomplishments, the interesting things that are found out, what kids are doing for their next steps, right? All of that to show the value of this time throughout the school year. So first up, we're thinking about providing time to explore interests. And next up, we're asking ourselves, right, our encouraged students to pose questions. So instead of just providing the time and letting kids go off to explore, we are also adding in this extra layer of encouraging students to pose questions that they have. Now, this can take a few different forms, could be more formal or informal, but it's really about creating an environment where students are comfortable asking questions both in a wide way so that everyone who is around them is engaging in that inquiry process, but also for their own independent piece. So encouraging students to pose questions and also connect to action items. You might ask students to take action based on a question they have, going off to find a place that might help them gather an answer, going out to interview someone or chat with someone who might be able to help them come to that answer or know that there is no one answer, but that they're headed in that right direction. The shift from engagement to agency here is all about that taking action. So valuing not only the questions that have answers, but those open-ended questions that might have more than one way to examine them, or that might ask students to go off and search and never find an answer, or not quite yet find an answer to their questions, is another way to encourage students that it is valuable and okay to pose questions, even if their questions there might not be one true answer for. When you do encourage students to pose questions, you may find that there are experts that can help support them with their answers. You might start off by connecting students with experts who can help them find answers to their questions, or giving them the space and the agency to search for and find the folks that can help them get to the next step in finding an answer for their question. This might lend itself well to connecting with organizations that students want to go deeper into, that they may want to intern with at some point, that they may want to be part of in a different way. So searching for relevant organizations that connect to students' questions is a great way to encourage students to continue this process of posing questions. So taking their highly engaging, in the flow learning experiences to the next level by providing an opportunity for them to truly take action based on what they're curious about and what they'd like to learn more about. Our next way to turn student engagement into student agency is to embrace social channels with a purpose. Now, for many students, they are consumers and might even be creators in social spaces. And these are spaces that might be scary to bring into a classroom environment or may feel intimidating to pull into conversations, especially if it's a platform for social media that you are not feeling particularly confident or well-versed in. But we can embrace these social channels with that clear purpose of supporting students who are going out to learn about a new topic, a new medium, and all of the pieces that might go along with it. So as we embrace social channels with a purpose, we might have students create social style content using social media style products, short videos, graphics, micro blogging, like a long caption on an Instagram post, as a way for them to create social style content that connects with a high interest topic that they are learning about. This action item of creation is important in all areas of a student's school day, but this is a great way for them to go a step further beyond being interested and in the flow from a content area perspective, to now taking more of a next step, putting that action alongside of it to create social style content. Now, this might not mean that they are posting a short video they made to a personal or school TikTok page, but it may mean that they are creating a graphic around a high interest topic, doing research that helps them form a 100-word caption that is then shared on a school social page. So really giving them an audience for their work if they are creating social style content might be something that you consider. You might also find that you are embracing social channels with a purpose of helping students know that they can go to social spaces to learn. Now, we all know that there is plenty of great and not so great information shared on social channels. So this also becomes an opportunity to thread in some of the social emotional learning goals that you might have around empathy building, about navigating on different spaces, and it might even align to digital citizenship goals that you have as well. But when it comes to the student agency and giving them the skills that they need to go out into the world, including digital and social spaces, you might find that you pull in examples or strategies of how students can go into areas to learn more about a particular topic, to find others to connect with, and leveraging some of the things that make those spaces so powerful. Now, this can go alongside any conversations you might have that guides the use of social media, both inside and outside of the classroom, right? Talking to students about authority of different resources and how they might go to one place or another to gather information, and setting that intention before they open up an app to go off and look at some of these different pieces. Now, all of this is not to sugarcoat or make it seem like every social space is perfect, but it's an opportunity to discuss some of the benefits or value adds of social media in the context of taking action. You might bring in relevant examples from your local community of things that were shared in a social space and created change. You might talk about how information is shared and spread in these spaces to make sure people are better informed. I know locally where I live, we had some weather systems come through this summer and fall. And one of the things that I know that I've shared with folks and have come back to is just how these different channels are used to share updates and warnings and ways to gather support after something has happened. So there's lots of things that you might look at with that student agency lens to help highlight some of the ways to use these spaces in a productive and purposeful way. So number three on our list is to embrace social channels with a purpose. And number four is to help students find like-minded peers, which is a great way to move them from an engaged situation to an one where they are taking action. So if students are in a space where they are highly interested in one topic, diving deep into something that might be high on a priority list from a curriculum perspective, or might be a subtopic that you're just scratching the surface of, or that they are just scratching the surface of with a classroom teacher. Helping students find like-minded peers can help them take that next step, find a community, and go deeper into a particular topic. So this can look different in different spaces, but you might decide that you are giving space within a school community for peer groups to meet, to dive deep into a topic, to form a plan of action if they are going to do something that requires a few next steps. So one way to help students find like-minded peers is to give space for peer groups that are inside of your local community, inside of a school, inside of a district, where students are coming together to talk and discuss or plan around a common focus that they are all expressing interest in. You might decide that if those groups are not there already for a student who's highly engaged in a particular topic but doesn't quite have a peer group locally to work with to accomplish a goal, that you facilitate far away partnerships. So you are searching for organizations that connect students across different time zones. You are looking for a partner class or a partner educator who is also diving deep into a particular topic as an opportunity to facilitate a far away partnerships and help students find like-minded peers that just might not be local peers or nearby. Now, you might decide that giving that space for a group meeting or finding someone who can join in on a Zoom call at the same time might be a challenge. So you might decide to locate asynchronous support. Asynchronous being our self-paced or work at your own time type of support. When it comes to helping students find like-minded peers who are interested and excited about the same things, they might be in a faraway spot where they cannot meet in a live manner. So locating places where students can connect in an asynchronous or self-paced way, this might include a student-friendly discussion board where they are posting questions or connecting, where they are having an opportunity to connect with a group of students who are diving deep into one topic. And they are not in the local place, but they are able to exchange information kind of at their own pace on their own schedule. Or you might find that you are working with students who have a high interest and are not quite ready to take a next step to connect with others just yet, but you're modeling ways to find connections so that they can build that muscle of where to go, where to search for, how to build community around a topic that they are interested and excited about learning more. So, as we look at these seven ways together, kind of bringing it back to some of those social emotional learning goals as well, you might find that students who are coming together in a peer group are also working on some social emotional skills around making decisions and compromising and feeling empathetic for someone who might come in with a different life experience than they do. So, these are all things that are ones you can keep in mind alongside some of the SEL goals you might have as well. So continuing to move us through our list and think about these seven ways, you might decide that you are ready to move a bit further, so away from, say, a peer group or carving out time for everyone to work on something at the same time, and that you want to connect students with mentors or experts in a particular field. This is something that can truly help move the needle from a student who is engaged and excited about a topic and then doesn't have much further to go by giving them a connection to someone who can help them simply soar diving deeper into a particular area or topic. It is a fantastic way to take a student who is engaged and excited about a particular piece of content and build off of that so that they can dive deeper. So as we think about connecting students with mentors, this can take many different forms, and it may be something that is evolving in terms of the way that you are locating folks or setting up different partnerships over the course of the school year. You might start off small with a few students who are interested in connecting with a mentor, or you might find a few mentors first. There's a few different ways to consider how this connection might look like in action. When you do connect students with mentors, it's an opportunity to bring career ideas to life. Just like that first thing I mentioned of you don't know what you don't know, right? If we haven't seen something in action, it's really hard for us to wrap our head around what it looks like in real life. And so to bring career ideas to life for students, connecting them with a mentor who can speak to their current career experience, what led them to that place, what got them to the space that they currently inhabit now, it can truly help bring career ideas to life so students can make a decision if that sounds interesting and exciting to them, if they're ready to align that choice with a passion that they have. A mentor can really help students see not only where they can go, but the process and the pathway in order to get to that specific place. Connecting students with a mentor also gives an authentic sounding board. It's one thing to talk about career aspirations or high interest topics with someone who is interested and curious and supportive, but it's quite another to talk to someone who is well-versed in the same topic, who can provide advice that is specific and actionable, and who has had relevant experiences that students can then use to make decisions. So giving students access to a mentor gives them access to an authentic sounding board, someone who can speak to their own experiences, can answer questions, can give advice and feedback on ideas that students have that are truly relevant and connected to the actual topic itself, which goes beyond having a supportive educator or a member in their life, but also ask them to kind of give them a little bit more specific feedback. It also provides a level of accountability when you connect students with a mentor, whether they are meeting with someone once a week or twice a month, or on a semi-regular basis, that is a person who they might set goals with, who they talk about big ideas with, who might give them action items to consider or commit to, and it provides a level of accountability for a student to take that next step, to move forward in whichever area they're interested in diving into a little bit more deeply. So connecting a student with a mentor can provide a level of accountability when there are the regular meetings, specific action items, but it also gives them someone from kind of outside of their everyday life who learns about them and gets to know them a little bit more differently and can do a check-in that might not feel like it's tied with a bunch of baggage or other things that are happening. And so the level of accountability there can be really unique. When you connect students with mentors, it can help students set goals that take a topic they're interested and engaged with to the next level. So this again comes back to the social emotional learning connection of helping students set goals, make decisions, demonstrate resiliency, overcome obstacles, all the things that we know are important skills for students to build in any part of their day. A mentor can truly help them dive deeper into these pieces. By helping students set a goal, a mentor is giving them feedback specific to an industry they have experience with, specific to an interest a student has explored. So the goal setting that can take place alongside with a mentor is going to feel deeper and different than if a student is setting a goal without the specific kind of feedback that a mentor with those experiences can give. So connecting students with a mentor is a big way to move from student engagement to student agency. When kids have demonstrated interest, and they've demonstrated excitement, they're curious about a particular topic, they're in the flow of learning about it, connecting with a mentor can truly help them take that next step, give them an opportunity to dive deeper, get specific questions answered, have someone who is helping them stay accountable and checking in as they set specific goals related to the areas that they want to explore a little bit more deeply. So as we move through our list, I want to bring us back to the social emotional learning piece again, just to revisit some of these pieces because you'll hear them come up in our last two. When we talk about the social emotional learning connection, we're thinking about self-awareness, self-management, social awareness, relationship skills, and those responsible decision-making pieces, all of which are threaded through the first five that we looked at today and that you'll see continue as we get to our last two on the list. So number six for us is to help students find an audience. And that term authentic audience is one that I brought up at the beginning of today. And as we think about helping students find an audience for their explorations, for things that they are diving into and interested in learning more about, helping them find an audience connects with this idea of them taking action, of them moving beyond simply being interested and excited to having that level of agency to go out and explore, to inquire about different pieces, and then produce something perhaps around a what it is that they're interested in learning more about. So to help students find an audience, there are a few things that you can do to give them other people who are going to be interested and excited about their interests. So one way to help students find an audience is to start off by letting them see their impact at a smaller scale. So if you are asking students to create something, to make something, to share something, really letting students see their impact in that classroom environment can help them build their confidence to share with a wider audience down the line. It's an opportunity for you to set a purpose for student projects, whether those are independent projects students are working on their own, or if it's ones that they are doing in a small group or in a bigger setting. By giving students an audience for their creations, for their work, however they are, or however you are looking at an output for what it is that they are making, you can really set a purpose for student projects by giving them an audience. The who is going to see and celebrate student work. Now, this can look very different in different settings, and when we really talk about giving kids the motivation to go out and explore, it often starts with that purpose. It starts with that audience, the who is going to be impacted by what students are making and creating. In this case, right, you might work side by side with students to identify their audience from the beginning. They're the ones who are saying, I want to create this or make this for this group to impact this group in a certain way. Or you might find an audience, that is ready to move or to make a change based on something students are sharing, right? All of that might come into play as well. Now, you can go beyond that independent study when you help student find an audience. Now, an independent study can sometimes feel for students like they are on their own, working on their own piece, perhaps with some check-in opportunities with an educator they're working under or with a mentor who's providing some expert support. But to go beyond an independent study that might feel like it's in a silo, You can help students find an audience so that they see their impact. This idea of moving from student engagement to student agency is all about taking action and kids going out and taking the lead as they are putting their interests, things they are curious about, out into the world. So if you are looking for students to find an audience to share their learning, this is a great way to go beyond an independent study. Now, to do this, you can create relevant opportunities for students. So giving them an opportunity to go out and work with an audience. So working with a group that is ready to use this information, use whatever it is students make or create. And these relevant opportunities could be ones that students have identified as being high interest to them, as being authentic to the way they interact in different spaces. It might include a problem that they have noticed in their community or in a larger scope that they are truly looking to solve or address in certain ways. So giving students an audience and helping them find that audience can really have a big change from just interest and engagement to really taking that level of agency for them to go off and make and create something that could truly have an impact. So for our number seven here on the list, to really push this forward for students, we want to make sure that there are time-sensitive action items so that they know what it is that they need to do in order to move forward. So developing time-sensitive action items comes back to some of the social-emotional learning pieces that we looked at earlier, and this idea of goal setting and responsible use of time that go along with what you'd like students to build from an SEL perspective as well. So developing time-sensitive action items is a great way to take an interest or a highly engaging moment and place that level of agency next to it. So for this type of piece, it's an opportunity to model goal setting for students in a way that is appropriate for the group that you are working with. This modeling of goal setting can take a few different forms. It might be part of an opportunity to create a timeline, to create benchmarks, to sketch out a big plan that students are going through. And this model of goal setting is an opportunity for students to see what it takes to get something done. So more than just I'm interested, I'm excited, but if I want to do this thing, I need to do these pieces in order to get there. So modeling goal setting can go alongside a project students are working on, something that they've decided they want to learn how to do, and breaking down those pieces might include some of the things that we've already looked at today with connecting students to a specific audience. Having a mentor that they check in with regularly might all be part of this process. So connecting the goals that students have to specific action items is a great way to bring it back to some of the SEL initiatives that you might have ongoing right now, but also to make sure that students are developing skills that they can take beyond a one environment, one-off project that they're working on. So by connecting goals to action items, you might have students develop a very specific plan so that they can measure the movement, so that they can measure their growth within a particular area. So connecting goals to action items could include the use of different digital tools that are collaborative or independent, where you have an opportunity to peek in, check in on students, have them make changes or amend different things as they are working towards a particular piece. So connecting goals to specific action items is an important part of taking a topic kids are interested in, things that they've shown that they enjoy doing, but taking that level of agency kind of on next. Setting benchmarks with students is an important way to make sure that any action items that students have set, any of the goal setting that they are doing, truly feels time sensitive and actionable. So setting benchmarks with students can take a few different forms. You might ask students to look at a big goal that they have, develop different action items that go along with it, and then set specific benchmarks for success along the way. Now, giving these benchmarks to students is not as wonderful or long-lasting as helping students develop these benchmarks themselves. So setting the benchmarks with students as opposed to for students is a key component here of developing these time-sensitive action items. So you want students to identify their bandwidth, their schedule, what it is that they can accomplish within a set time, and be realistic as they are setting those benchmarks to say, I'm moving in the right direction, I have what I need in order to reach that particular goal. So as you're setting benchmarks with students, it's an opportunity to think aloud, to push them, really look at what it is that they want to accomplish and what they can accomplish within a particular time. You really want to create an achievable schedule with students, and this comes back to the pieces with setting benchmarks. We want to create an achievable schedule where students are going to find success with their goals. Now, it doesn't mean that you are making things too easy, right, or not interesting for students, but it's truly about helping set them up for success by creating a schedule that truly is achievable so they can reach their goals and that you are checking in along the way. An achievable schedule might be one that shifts and changes and moves over the course of the time that kids are working on a particular goal. It's an opportunity for you to model and talk with students about the need to move things around or change things up or shift time allocations in order to reach a particular goal. So developing time-sensitive action items, right, is more than just the modeling of goal setting and saying this is a great way to goal set a goal, that's a part of it, but to really show students that they need to have action items, benchmarks, that they need to have an achievable schedule that might also go alongside any type of feedback you, a peer, or a mentor is giving them. So as we look at these seven ways together today, I want to bring us back to those terms we started off with today of student engagement and student agency. When we talk about student engagement, we know when we see it is often how we think about student engagement, but we're creating a high interest environment for students, one where they're working on something that really grabs their attention. We've created an environment that supports students' interests, where their interests are truly valued and they're really in the flow of learning. This is the foundation for being able to turn student engagement into student agency, and it's truly a crucial part of making sure that we can go to that next level of building that independence and that motivation for students. So when we think about what is student agency today, it includes that student choice. And one thing you heard me say as we went through our seven ways a few times today is this idea of making sure that student choice is valued, that they have an opportunity to work within small groups, work within an independent study, explore something that they're truly interested and excited to learn more about. It honors student voice. People are listening to them, whether it's that audience that they are creating something to share, whether it's that mentor that they are able to bounce ideas off of and get real and relevant feedback right back to them. Right? Or perhaps it's an opportunity for them to ask questions. We're truly thinking about student voice, we're providing relevant experiences for them so that they are able to make connections to what happens outside of the classroom, and we're providing that authentic audience so that we are able to connect back what it is that they are interested and excited about to their agency, those next steps of things that they will take. So before we jump into our Q&A, those seven ways to turn student engagement into student agency again are to provide time to explore interests, truly carving out time and valuing that time, making it a non-negotiable for students. Encouraging students to pose questions, even open-ended questions that they might not have a real one answer to, but that they're ready to investigate further. To embrace social channels with a purpose of sharing, a purpose of learning from these spaces. To help students find like-minded peers, whether they're right there in their community or far away partners that they're able to connect with. To connect students with mentors, experts in a field that can give feedback and offer support and push students in a way that someone in a school building might not have the same experiences to be able to support. To help students find an audience, moving that engagement to the impact of student agency. To develop time-sensitive action items is our final one on the list to really help students put all of this into action as they move forward throughout the school year. So I will pass it back over to you, Emily, for any questions that might have popped in, and just let me know if you need me to move a slide or two ahead as we finish up today.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Monica. You covered a lot of information in those 7 points and gave us all some great strategies that we can start using with our students right away and throughout this school year. So just a reminder, because lots of folks have asked, we are going to be sending the recording and the slide deck out tomorrow. So keep an eye out for that. In that email, there will also be a link to download a great report from Student Success Agency about student engagement, specifically during distance learning. This report looked at how many schools stayed connected with students and kept them engaged in learning through a powerful combination of mobile devices and real live human beings. So this report, again, is focused on the distance learning that happened primarily last school year in March 2020 as well. But there's lots of lessons in this that can really be applied now that we're back, hopefully, in physical classrooms, or if you do have those periods where you're needing to do distance learning again. So again, keep an eye out for that email that will have the link to download the report. There is a link on your screen as well if you want to jot that down, but you'll be able to click through it tomorrow when we send you that. I also just want to send another thank you to Student Success Agency for bringing Monica here with us today. Again, Student Success Agency is a really unique platform that connects students with their very own agent, who is a near-age person and highly trained. This person is available on demand from students' mobile devices, and agents are there to support students socially, emotionally, and academically. Agents also provide insights to educators and counselors so that they can better help support students. So it's a really collaborative process between both the students and their agents, and then the agents and educators. The agents with Student Success Agency just become a part of your team and really make it possible to connect with every student and address their individual needs. It's a great way to extend the bandwidth of your own internal team. So I encourage you to look at studentsuccess.co, their website, for more information. And again, we'll also send some information in that email that you'll receive tomorrow. All right, let's go ahead and take the questions that have come in. We'll just do as much as we have time for. So several folks that have joined us are maybe at the elementary or middle school level today and really loved what you shared, but wondered about maybe some modifications for students that may have lesser levels of maturity or self-motivation.
Absolutely. So one of the ones that really sticks out or jumps out for me, especially when talking about early learners or elementary school learners, is really demonstrating the value of asking questions and giving students an audience. And the idea of giving students an audience might seem a little big or a little bit of a higher or secondary level when we think about students publishing something online or sharing something on social media, but it's really about giving someone, giving students an opportunity to connect with an audience or a group that really values their learning. So questioning might be a part of it, really pushing kids to wonder, to share what they're curious about, connecting them with an expert who is maybe not one-to-one with them but might be a whole class expert who can answer their questions about a topic, and then providing an opportunity for them to make or create or share something around that topic they're interested in. So for example, you might do a project on the rainforest with a group of second graders, and you're asking students to pose questions and wonder about different pieces. And then you do a video conference call with someone who is a botanist and studies all sorts of plants in the rainforest. And then perhaps students create some informational pieces of writing that they share with an organization or with another group of students who are learning about the topic. So that idea of building agency can come in lots of forms. It might feel like there are more specific opportunities for students with a career connection at a secondary level, but we can start building that capacity with students at an early age as well.
Great, thank you. That was helpful. And I also just want to point out, and I am embarrassed to point this out, but we do have a typo in the studentsuccess.co URL there. It's missing an S. So it is student success with two S's at the end. So just a note for that. And oh, thank you, Monica, just fixing it right there on the fly. Thank you. I need to do a little closer proofreading on that. All right, another question. So how do you get administrator buy-in for student agency, particularly now when everyone is focused on catching up with academics? You know, you talked a lot about social emotional learning. So how do you start conversations with school leadership and administrators around this kind of topic?
Such an important question, because we know in order to do these things, we need to carve out time, right, and have that support at all levels. So the social emotional learning connection may be your starting point when you are having a conversation with a school administrator around carving out time or connecting students with mentors or things that might not seem high priority on paper, right, or might not be high priority on someone's list right now, right? We know that these connect to those high priority items, and that they really expand upon all the pieces, and that the social emotional learning piece is core for all the things, right? It's a foundation for building that academic success. So I would come back to SEL goals, commitments that are being made around social emotional learning. You might even find a line in a school or district mission statement that helps reinforce that commitment to those pieces. So that might be something that you're looking at. You might look to some of the statistics in the report you heard mentioned earlier that might help lend itself well to some of the conversations that you have. So I think really valuing that SEL piece, talking about how to carve out time, perhaps working with a small group to start and be ready to scale. Those are a few things that I would come into a conversation with the school administrator with.
Thank you. Those are helpful. And you had mentioned CASEL earlier, and I know on their website, which is CASEL.org, they have lots of resources about that connection between social emotional learning and academics as well, to further arm yourself with research, as Monica mentioned. So two questions that sort of have a similar piece at the heart of them. So the first is, how do you see these engagement strategies differing for English learners and recent immigrants who may not come from a culture where self-agency or agency is something that they're used to? And a similar question on just suggestions for drawing students out who may not really express interest in anything, you know, kind of breaking down some of those barriers.
So one big thing I would start, both for students who might show low interest or might not express their interest or might not feel comfortable expressing their interest, even though they have lots of things they're curious about, is to model these practices as much as possible. Be really transparent about your own thinking, your own curiosity, what passion projects you are working on. Make sure that that's something that you circle back to, that you're giving updates to. So even just being a model of someone who takes that next step is a way to start. So providing examples, pointing towards other people in the school community who are doing this work, bringing in someone to share what might seem like a quick or not very notable story might be something that really prompts students to dive deeper or feel more comfortable talking about what they're interested in. If you're looking to help push students to think a little bit more broadly or to ask more questions, of course, modeling might be part of that, but you might even want to explore some virtual resources that provide opportunities for students to look around or up and down in different parts of the world. Maybe not a formal virtual field trip, but some resources that help them explore different spaces. That might be something that you want to bring in to working with the group, just to give them some new ways to look at the world and things that might spark their curiosity.
All right. Well, let's just squeeze in one last question. So you did mention quite a bit kind of bringing in people from the outside. So do you have any suggestions for recruiting, you know, particularly career mentors? You know, kind of what is the sell to those people outside the school community?
Well, I would first start local, right? As much as it might be tempting or useful to go into a social space and reach out to someone who's far away, we all know the power of video connections for people who aren't able to meet face to face. You might start with community members. And so for them, the value add might be that they're giving back to their community, that they are participating in something that is local. So that might be the way that it starts. There might also be a networking component that you're offering to add some of these folks that are coming in. Perhaps there's an extra value add of a community network or a special event that takes place at the end of the year to celebrate some of these mentors, where they can connect with other folks who are in the community doing great work or interested in partnership. So that community aspect might be a value add for them. But going out into local spaces, people who already have some level of interest in your school or district, that's a great place to start.
Yes, well, we have run up to the end of our time, but thanks for taking those questions that you did, and thanks to everybody who sent those in. It was great conversation. So thanks for being here with us today. And thank you again to Student Success Agency for sponsoring the webinar. And just as a reminder, a final reminder, you'll get an email tomorrow with a link to the recording, a link to the slide deck, a link to that student engagement report I mentioned, as well as your certificate of attendance. You'll want to scroll to the very bottom of the email, look for the big blue button that says My Certificate, click on that. And you may want to go pour yourself a cup of coffee, because it can take as long as 90 seconds for that certificate to download. So just let it sit there, and I promise you it will pull up and you'll be able to get it. So it was wonderful to spend time with you today, Monica, and with everyone in our audience, and I hope everyone has a wonderful rest of your day, a great week, and a fantastic school year. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.